It is form versus content, who's your mama? And I'm very, very pleased to invite you. We are live streaming this on Play TV, so I would like to say hello to our hashtag universe. If you Twitter or tweet, you can log on, I think, to use the hashtag NewPlateTV and hashtag BAPF. And we're going to keep the house lights up. I don't know if they went down, but if they did, we can bring them up a little bit. Because there will be a conversation going on online as well as in this room. If there are questions, Kevin, are you going to field questions on NewPlateTV? Are you here?
Which one?
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Great, I'll throw them out.
So my name is Amy Mueller, and I'm the Artistic Director of Playwrights Foundation, and I feel a little funny standing in front of everybody, so I'm going to come over to here. We decided to do this topic, because of the work that's on this year's Bay Area Playwrights Festival. And by that I mean the work that each of the plays, we're doing six plays this year, and it's not atypical of the diversity of work, certainly, but it's quite marked this year that each of the plays really follows a very specific formal aesthetic. Each one had the ways in which the aesthetic, the form, and the content speak to each other, inform each other, and deliver each other, and theatrically speaking, is really keen and very specific. And so, thinking about what we'd like to talk about this year, it seemed like a really great conversation to have. And I think that this conversation isn't had very often, and I think it's as far as I'm concerned from the artistic director position of a play development center, really is the topic for the 21st century, for a new generation of theater makers. And so we're really, really interested in the kinds of theater that's being written, the form in which it takes, and the forms that are, the ways in which theater is being articulated, and also the boundaries that are being broken open in the way we think about theater, the way we think about a play, the way we think about the way in which we're delivering either a message or a feeling or an evocation of our contemporary zeitgeist, for lack of a better term. That word is bandied about a lot during the course of the festival. On a personal note, I come from, many people don't actually know this about me, but my early experience as a theater person, theater maker, performer, was with dance. I danced for almost 20 years. I was a modern dancer, and if you know much about choreography and modern dance, it is a completely different kind of language, a completely different kind of vocabulary that expresses theatrical ideas in a very, very specific ways. And the formal aspects of dance are usually completely overshadowed. The content, and maybe not overshadow is quite the right word, but deliver the content. And the delivery system is a completely different kind of vocabulary than language. And I've always been really interested in how language can, and choreography, or language and theatrical form are wedded. And I have a very particular personal interest in that. And so come on in, Patricia, it's fine to see, we're informal here. So that's my own personal, particular interest in the subject matter. And the panel that we put together today, I think is gonna unpack some of those those specific ideas. So with that, I'm going to introduce our facilitator, moderator, and fellow playwright, Lauren Gunderson. Many of you know Lauren. She is a playwright, she is a blogger, she is a Twitterer. She's been called ubiquitous, and her work is stunning. And she's a resident playwright at Playwrights Foundation. She's an alumni of the Bay Area Playwrights Festival and lots of our programs. And she also is a teacher in the New Play Institute. And when I thought about somebody to moderate this panel, she came to mind because she teaches a class called PlayMath. And I think he's going to talk a little bit about what that means to her and carry forward from there. So with that.
Yeah, hi everybody. Thanks for being here and for being somewhere in the world online watching this. I was really excited when Amy asked me to do this, partly to hear what all of you are doing and talking. So I'm not going to not talk that much so that we can really collide these versions and definitions that I think are very distinct to each play, not to mention each playwright and each project and each collaboration. But what I love about this conversation is that form and content, obviously, you can't really separate them. You can talk distinctly about them, but I think as soon as you move content a certain way or move form a certain way, it tugs at the other. So in and of itself, it's not just a story. By being on stage, it has adopted the form of the medium that we're involved in. So actors on stage, it's different than all the other forms of storytelling because of that. So I think even the simplest, most realistic, if that's the simplest version of a play, has an inherent form that is reflected and helps digest the content and produce it as well. So I'm really delighted to kind of figure out how form and content are wed, if they are, how they are fighting, if they are, how they help to co-build and co-birth the stories that we love. Being a little sciencey and math-minded, as Amy mentioned, I'm fascinated partly because it seems, I just read an article this morning talking about the neuroscience of storytelling, and there's been a lot of discussion about this in the last couple of decades as neuroscience has gotten better, but one of the things they talk about is that a story, the human brain developed in a certain way that makes story what it is. We didn't invent it out of the air. It's because of the way we think, we interpret, we learn, we speak, we communicate, that story exists at all, that we want a story to start somewhere about something and some or someone, develop to a point where that person wants something, see if they get it, and what happens when they do or don't. That's kind of what most story is, that's what a lot of journalism is about, that's what how you say when you did at school today, or what a recipe is. You know, all of these forms reflect kind of that simple, almost biological, very much biological, neurological pattern that we expect. And so how that affects this form and content discussion. As I was talking with Laura, who's a fabulous dramaturg and a professor, about this, that structure isn't the same thing as form, or is it? And of course that, and structure, is that more content than form? So I think all of this is going to be really great. Lightly, as I said, I wasn't going to talk in here, I am talking for 10 minutes. So the introductions are going to be brief so that we can get to talking. We have with us Abi Basch, who's a fabulous playwright and a director, and her company that are spread out. So I'll let you all introduce yourself. You want Abby's down there. J.C. Lee is a fabulous playwright who is from the Bay Area, just graduated from Juilliard. His plays are marvelous, hysterical, really smart. He also has a political mind in his blogging world, too, so keep in touch with him. The real world, which is always nice to check in with every now and then. We have Laura, who's a dramaturg. I mentioned Professor Mark Jackson, who's your director and playwright and just general creator who has, probably don't need to introduce him here, his reputation is deep and wide and wonderful, and more of the Abby's group here. Let's start with introducing the rest of Abby's ensemble so we know who we're all talking to, and then we'll dive in.
Sorry, we've sort of overtaken the stage.
It's great.
I'm Abi Basch, I'm a playwright and director, and Elsa Marie Lopwick is leading actress of Odin Tan Trent and a director in her own right. She is coming to guest direct and co-direct with me on this production, so she's a visiting artist with us here. We're very lucky to have her. Caroline is our production manager and dramaturg at large. Paula is our resident composer. And down there we have Molly Scheiken, one of our actors, and Stephanie Fiedler, another actor, and one of our actors, Torsten Behe, is missing, which is why there are enough chairs for him.
And Amy will kind of be a panelist as well, because there's some interesting work in her. So what I'd love to throw out, and we're just going to be chatting, so we'll try to ironically be not super formed here, so we'll be formless. But the question that I want to start with is, just to put it out there, do you think about form and content as you're creating? And if you do, how? And if you don't, when do you? If you ever do. Just basically, in the process of creation, do you think about these things? Do you think about one or the other? Do you think about which one first, et cetera? And I think because we have a great diversity of panelists, from directors and actors and dramaturgs, that whatever perspective, please speak from that. Jay, I'm going to be you, Jay.
Sure. I tend not to think about it consciously. I think that my relationship to, I mean, form, when I hear the word form, I tend to think of narrative. And to me, narrative is the means by which we derive meaning from the world. I think that narrative is sort of the natural relationship, and it's the way we structure everything that we digest, from journalism to politics to science. I think we are always seeking out a narrative. And so the narrative for me is always sort of inherent in the work. I'm always sort of figuring out, well, what is the story I'm telling? And then I think depending on the story, an aesthetic emerges. So certain stories demand, certain stories might want a very realistic aesthetic, and then I think some stories want a more abstract aesthetic. But to me, the narrative is the thing that provides meaning. I think without the narrative, you don't have meaning. For my
work. Yeah. We have this wonderful picture of Molly from Abby's play, Arctic Hysteria, which is on currently in May. Would you talk a little bit?
Sure.
Sit over there.
Sure. I think when I start writing a play, the first thing that comes to me are images, very strong images that I don't understand and need to figure out. And from that, when I start figuring out what I want to be questioning or what I can't figure out, then I think about how the structure, how the container, as Susan Lloyd Parks calls the container and the content and her elements of style essays. Then I start thinking, how do I want to express this? How do I want to tell this? So for Arts and Hysteria, and also for my work with Kinderdeutsch, because we're such a collaborative unit, I usually will create a structure for a script, and then we explore it, as we did last summer at Odin Teatre in Denmark. I watch the actors, they experiment with stuff, and I leave room, just tons of empty space. There are almost no stage directions in my scripts because the actors are the stage directions, and the composer. So my first step is thinking about the image, and then I automatically think about the structure, because each of the structures where it plays is fundamentally different. So, I get about it.
I'm not sure what to jump in with. I mean, because in a way, it seems like we're talking about form and content, but we're just talking about theater in general. I never thought of it as separate. And it almost seems odd that we even have to ask the question, because I don't know how. If you go to the theater, there's nothing there. There's no form to see. You're not going to be able to understand what the content is. So it is something I think about, to think intuitively, like you were saying. And that it starts from what is the subject matter of the piece and what's going to capture that best, and sometimes that means it needs to be dance, because that's going to be the most articulate way to express it, and sometimes people need to talk back to each other because that's going to be the most articulate way. Quite generally.
For me, I don't know what you're talking to as a writer, but I come from a slightly different perspective because I work as a dramaturg and as a director, and for me, I do think about it all the time, because I feel like whether you're dramaturging a play or directing a play, you have to be in an intimate conversation about what is the dramaturgy of that play. And so you have to be thinking about form, between the content, and also that other element, structure, right? Because for me, the form is like just kind of a, another code word for the style. You know, are we doing realism? Are we doing hip hop theater? Are we doing this, that, and the other? But then there's that other question of the structure of a play. And I think that that's something that I think is an important conversation to have, whether you're working with a playwright as a dramaturg or whether you are looking at a play with or without the playwright in the room as a director, in terms of understanding the architecture of a play. And I think that's incredibly important today in the 21st century as we're getting all of this new media and the way that people take in information is really different. And with your grounding in science, you talk a lot about, and you think a lot about the way the human brain takes in information. And what we're starting to find out is that all of this media that we have is changing the way that we take information in, and it's changing our brain chemistry. It's changing the way our brains are wired. And so this question of structure, I think, and form are really important. And so for me, when you're, since you mentioned her and I love her, Susan Laurie Parks, when you're looking at a Susan Laurie Parks play, you have to really look into what she calls her whole of history. And she, I think, is a good, particularly for emerging playwrights who are have questions about how to structure a play, or what is the form of a play, she's a good person to look to, because you can look into her whole of history, and right there is where all of her form, content, and structure are mirrored. So you can look into her whole of history, and you can see sitting there Bertolt Brecht, sometimes, and you can see Samuel Beckett sitting there, and you can see Amiri Baraka and Ibn Sefi Shenge, and then you can also see in terms of content, the big ideas, the big thinkers inside of there. And I think being able to break it down and understand it on that level so that you can get to a successful production means dealing with all of that and figuring out how those elements talk to each other in a production, if that makes sense at all. I mean, understanding Susan Laurie Parks's where she fits in sort of as an African-American artist and the homage that she plays to sort of West African call and response, to but also to some of the experiments from the Black Arts Movement in the 60s and 70s with Amiri Baraka and Sapi Shenge. And I think that's really important if you're going to do the play well, to understand how she marries that with some very Brechtian sort of alienation techniques. And I think when I see productions of her work that are successful, it's been because they have had directors and dramaturgs and they understand that. And how that is used to express the big idea she's getting at. And when I've seen productions that don't work so well, it seems like they haven't really understood how that all comes together.
Well, because, and I think that I agree with that, and I think that it's true because form gives content meaning.
Yes.
I think without form, without a specificity of structure, content has no meaning. It's sort of like, you know, if you want, I think what, you know, and when you look back at sort of like the last century of work, you know, there was sort of a push to test the boundaries of narrative structure and say, what can we do? How can we break this structure down? And I think actually what it taught us was that you can break it down, but to successfully tell a story, there has to be an awareness of it. And that the form is going to give the content meaning. If you, content without form, it doesn't have any sort of expressive value for my money. I think you have to, it has to be within a structure, narrative structure, we can sort of observe it and say, oh, this is the story being told. And that's the way in which I'm going to derive meaning from it.
But I do think at a certain point sometimes that it's the breaking of form that suddenly becomes content, because when the play happens to the hero, heroine, main character, there is a formalistic kind of a grip that they're doing, or the architecture is making a lot of points, whether it's dreamlike, whether it's musical, whether it's, they have direct address ability, they can have access to the audience or they can't. It's when those things change and break immediately that it suddenly becomes emotional for people watching and invested in that main character. I think that's one of those kind of fault lines that's really interesting. Like, I've actually seen some of your work, the production of Voice in Underwater in Atlanta. what I love so much about all of your work, but especially that one because I finally got to see the production, is that there were these physicalized moments that felt, even though they were doing something that had an intellectual, it hit me intellectually. It was when it was broken and the form was shared, or the physicality was shared with the characters on stage, that it became an emotional thing. And it became suddenly that something that you feel here, not something that's just up here. And I think because we're not only just telling stories, but theatrical ones, we're trying to hit that part. If it doesn't have that part, the emotion. And it can be a gymnastics for theater, you know, it can be very lovely and or shocking or very witty, but it's when that form can inform the content, i.e. the reason you're telling it, like what's happening to this person, who is this person, what do they want, why do they want it so much that we're going to sit there and watch them for 12 hours if you're doing some productions, or two if you're doing others. So I'm kind of very interested in keeping us, or to figuring out what is the intellectual exercise of it, and the intellectual bravery of doing something formally, and then where it lands, and maybe some of the actors and performers can talk about that as it landing emotionally, that landing in the kind of the actor place.
I was going to ask actually if anyone in the company, the actors, or Caroline, or you know, Molly, who actually was in that production, and asking because we've worked now together since 2005, it's our fourth production together, and each piece changes, and the way we work changes. So I was curious to hear from, you know, all the composers, you know, Caroline, the actors, you know, how you approach the form differently each time because the content shifts, or if you've had that experience, or I don't know if that question makes sense.
I have a response. I think in our relation, like in this play we're doing right now, it seems to me almost like our form, there's a story, there's a content there. I mean, there's King Lear sort of loose structure behind it. But when you put our form, which in this play, we've laid over or layered over, you know, ice dancing, game show sort of moments, all kinds of forms that you may not recognize as a spectator, but it fractures our content in such a way that you can build it back up for yourself as an audience member. And that is, I think, where the emotional content comes from. And I think that it really fits in with what you said about how we process information now in this age where it's so tailored to you, and everything you want is right there, and you can digest it in very, very small verticals. And I think that's why our play, especially this one for me, seems very digestible almost, and exciting, because you can make whatever you want out of it, and there's still some content underneath. Because it's made out of so many small particles.
Yeah, because I think you have a story, and then you fracture it into these different forms.
And it's like chronologically, there's linkage that happens just because you're watching something and then you're watching this thing, and it's that kind of hyperlinked thing.
Yeah,
in fact, that's part of what that article, I remember an article about how it's changing our brain, and it is because we're looking for connections more than this is the thing that I'm dealing with right now. It's what spindles off of it, that the way the web works. So that's it. It's a cool way to think about
that. I think it also affects the way, I mean, we've been talking mostly about new plays right now, but I also think it affects the ways in which we produce the classics, because I came to sort of theater, a lot of people start out the classics and then go to new plays. I sort of started out in new play development at the Magic Theater and at the Bay Area Playwrights Festival when I was 5, as Emilie and I discussed. And then moved on and started doing dramaturgy on the classics over at Cal Shakes. And, you know, I can honestly say as an audience member that when I go to quote-unquote the well-made play from the 19th century nowadays, there is nothing I want to see less than talk, 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 talk. The stage goes black, people in black scurry around and change the set, and the lights come back up and we just pretend that didn't happen, because my brain has been rewired by all the new media so that when that happens, I want to go like this and change the channel, or I want to go time check the email. You know, and so I think it affects even the way that we produce, how can we produce these great works so that they don't feel like museum pieces, so they don't feel like this is theater that's good for you because you need to know the classics. How can we do that thing that Artaud talked about not making it a museum piece, but really making it a piece of our living culture today that reflects the community that we live in. because that's what makes that stuff great, right? Not, I mean, if we did plays, if we did Shakespeare's plays, I mean, I hate to inform this to, you know, sort of the Oxfordians that in English departments, but if we did plays exactly the way Shakespeare did in his time, it would be a very peculiar experience, and I think a lot of people would just be sort of like, huh? You know, so this idea. What? Yeah, really. Well, we can drink and make the prostitutes and they're great. But I think it would also be this very debilitating experience for an audience where I think a lot of people would just be like, I don't know what's going on here. Or if we could go back and do plays just as they were done by Euripides, I think I would frankly be, for the first 5 or 10 minutes, intrigued by the differentness and then a little bored maybe. And so how... I was always bothered by this notion of authenticity. Can we find an authentic Shakespeare? It's like, they weren't that interested in that in Shakespeare's time, so you know, why should we be kind of slavish about it now? So I think that this conversation about form and content and how to reach a contemporary audience is something that you need to have not only with new plays but with the classics as well.
I think that's a conversation about time, in my opinion. I think the social media sort of explosion that everybody's like, let's tweet in the theater now. It's like, I really think this is actually a conversation about time, and it's our relationship to time, right? Because I think we live in an age where we have so many options on how we could theoretically spend our time. I can spend an hour a night on Facebook, I can spend an hour a night on Twitter, I can spend an hour a night watching television, I can go to the theater, I can go watch a sports game. I have so many options available to me, and I think that when you retreat back in history, people had less options. Like, in London, when Shakespeare was there, he was kind of like, well, I guess we'll go to the theater, because that's like the only thing we can afford to do.
executions.
Yeah, public executions or Hamlet.
Yeah.
The execution tutor. And I think that the real question, you know, when I'm sitting down to write a play now, I instinctively feel like, wow, I don't want an intermission in this play. Because I know that for myself, when I go to the theater, intermission hits, and I'm like, all right, I'm going to go on Facebook now. And literally, I disengage from the dramatic event immediately. And I think that this question about form and content and our relationship to the classics and how it's played out now is really a question about our attention spans and our time. And that's not to say, like, oh, it's awful nowadays because we all have so much else we can do, and I used to walk 2 miles in the snow and be able to walk and play. I don't think about that. I just think we have a different relationship now. And so the question is just, how do we negotiate that relationship, and how does structure communicate with that?
And we do know from the scientific studies that have been done that people really, particularly young people, can't focus for that long anymore. You know, I mean, in Shakespeare's day, people would go to church all day long, whether they wanted to or not, because it was part of the law, you know,
right.
And they would talk all day long, and you were used to listening to hours and hours of long rhetorical arguments and taking in that information and memorizing it. We just don't do that anymore. We don't learn that way. And so kind of being aware of our audiences and how they take in information and how they respond to it, I think is so important when we're having this conversation about how plays are moving forward in the future.
I would add to that, I mean, maybe even argue with it a little bit, is that I feel like we tell ourselves that a lot, and we're told that a lot, and kids especially are told, you have a short attention span, and that way they'll buy more shit from you. But in actuality, you know, if you interest the kid, they'll be interested for as many hours as you keep them interested. I think it's an idea that is true, perhaps because we buy into it a lot and we promote it and allow it to happen. But I sat next to a kid. He was probably 14, and it was Hamlet, and it was about 3.5 hours. And at the end, he was so mad he booed. The actor playing Hamlet, he didn't like it, and I thought, wow, he didn't have any trouble sitting through that thing, and he didn't even like it, apparently. This was not in this country. I don't imagine seeing a teenager like that around here, but maybe because they're not giving an opportunity to do it, or the attention span that we all have, which is our lifespan, is not encouraged, you know. This, the mere idea that, well, I should... If there's no intermission in it, then if it's feeding the story, then that's great. But the idea to and you hear people talking these terms, make sure it's 90 minutes and there's no intermission or people won't pay attention. If we encourage them to think that way, they'll do it. But if we say, here's a 7-hour play, and it'll change the way they think about it. Assuming it's good, you know, both the 90-minute and 7-hour play. There's actually an interesting book that Jonathan Cowell wrote recently called Great Lengths, I think. And it's about theater experiences. I forget them. I think he said, if it's up to 3 hours, people get very upset. Once you pass 4.5 hours, they relax totally. And if they go into it and they're like, I'm going to be here for 7 hours, okay, they're not, they have no problem. But if you go, well, it's 2.5 hours, and there's an intermission, they go, oh. You know, just because they're conditioned. But there's something about deciding for yourself you're going to commit to a certain amount of time that you become miraculously patient, regardless of what Google tells you.
Well, I agree with that statement. I mean, I don't think what I meant to say was it's a question of ADHD. I think it's a question of autonomy, right? Like, I think it's just that we have so many more options that we could theoretically do that I think our relationship to time is just different, right? I think, because I've sat through a 4.5-hour King Lear, and it was probably the greatest theatrical experience of my life, you know what I mean? And I was in a room full of lots of different diverse people, and they all felt the same way. So it's simply a question of, well, how does that changed relationship to time that we have, how does that affect the way in which we tell stories? I think is actually just the larger question. Not necessarily, we can only tell stories in X number of minutes, but how is the fact that people have other options affect the way in which we tell stories?
I think that might go back to that concept. If the content is so rich, and so beautiful, or so true, or so wrathful, or something intensive, then I think people will have a reaction to it, whether it's 7 hours or 90 minutes, that you can hold it in your heart, and it's that thing that you're going to be thinking about months from now. So I think that keeps it's not just, let's keep breaking form to break it. It's, well, you can break it, but as long as that emotional truth, or as long as that intellectual depth or the vigor and of it is stark and exciting. I think content is an easy thing to kind of to twist, whereas a form is an interesting thing to twist and an easier one to kind of break off and attach here and the legs up here and then whatever, and kind of go, okay, let's see if it still walks. Whereas content is, I think, that rich thing that we can kind of know it. And you go, oh, this is a play, it's funny, but I didn't really like the characters, or something like that, or I didn't understand why this was important, or it didn't feel real to me, or it didn't feel like it mattered, the love story didn't, whatever. All of those things seem to be more content, more like, do we care about these people? Are they fighting for something big, or is it so funny that they're fighting for something so ridiculous, that you love it? And it's a more nebulous, kind of non-scientific space of, do you like it?
I do think that people can help with this problem that Mark's talking about, where a lot of it is culture. I mean, we do know from the science that our brains are being sort of rewired by some of the stuff, but a lot of it is culture. And I think one thing that theater companies and educators can do is to help particularly the younger generation with some of these skills. When I teach in the classroom, one of the things that I make them do, and they hate it, not only do you have to write, right, and express yourself in something other than a soundbite or a tweet, but I also make you read it aloud to your colleagues in the class, and then when you have done that, I ask the class, okay, so what was that about? And what's really interesting is that it is true, there is an inability to sort of listen and think through things. And just on that basic level, it's a skill that has to be worked on. About, if I read something to you for 5 or 10 minutes, and then say, okay, what just happened? What's really surprising is to find out the number of people who kind of give you a blank stare now. And that's interesting for me to think about as a theater artist when we're talking about marrying form and content, about what other things can help support that storytelling besides what you were saying, just the narrative, and even in which ways we can get that out there.
I wanted to sort of jump on this whole bandwagon of sort of media, internet brain rewiring. I think about how actually, when you're saying content, is this essential we connect to, Lauren? Form teaches us, I believe, how to perceive that content. And that form, and using that form to break the constructs that people perceive on every day, that they, you know, just have things at their fingertips, finding ways to have silence in performance, finding ways to have engagement between humans that is live and tangible, and I don't mean like falling over the audience necessarily, but I mean having live human interaction, being in the center of what we do, otherwise we'd all be in the film.
Yeah.
You know, so I think that liveness and finding ways to surprise people with form, for me personally as an artist, that is why I am interested in theater. I'm interested in breaking what people recognize as classic forms. My plays often start with conventional living room, like the play we're doing now, and then break open into something unexpected and ask the audience to go with it and enjoy it and laugh. And like, you guys are weirdos, and I am too, and I'm with you, and I feel alive. This play right now we're doing, Arts of Hysteria, is all about temporary madness, and it came from reading about Eskimos going insane in the most dark and desperate times for 24 hours, being tied down to a sled and remembering nothing. And I felt like I wanted to do that too. I think everyone in our company did also. So the idea, the concept for this play is that we go insane during the play. We have Arctic Hysteria for this period of an hour and 15 minutes, and the audience goes with us, and at the end, it's finished. And so there's a release in that. And so the construct, the form of it, and how it's told invites people to experience something in a new way. That's the idea anyway. But I wanted to sort of talk about the liveness. I think that the liveness is the essence of this, and that what we do isn't just about feeding into the internet culture and the mediated culture, but that it's about challenging people to break that and connect with each other. Because I think at least that's what I want to use. But I was wondering if we could have some of the Kinderdeutsch people, the collaborators of the playwrights, talk about how that sort of affects their process. How do you guys perceive, and not only the Kinderdeutsch, but how do you perceive when you're working with colleagues in theater and performance? How do you perceive form as transforming, you know, in relation to what you're doing? That's okay.
Well, I mean, I think that because we're not engaged with writing things, you know, we're receiving the script, the month's script. I think it's a really interesting opportunity in terms of using form because, I mean, we do highly physical theater, but even non what is the idea of physical theater, or traditional script, or whatever we want to call it. Form provides this perfect opportunity to provide whatever is going on in the script to provide a meeting place for the audience, I think, through the performer. Because giving form to what is written allows whatever is going on for me as a performer doesn't have to necessarily match what's going on for the audience, but it provides this, the form provides a meeting place for that to happen, and those two kind of consciousness areas can collide and perhaps create a meeting and engage the audience to keep them engaged in the script.
Could you give a concrete example?
A concrete example?
No,
a
specific.
So for example, I'm given a script, and there's, you know, any kind of amount of text, and it's written in any form based on what the playwright has written. And what I perceive in the script, and what I create as an actor, whatever my impulse is to create as an actor in an ideal situation, allows me to create a form to that, whatever that is, with my voice and my body and gestures and anything that I can create and is shaped by any of the directed resolution. And so what I'm experiencing on stage with my other performers isn't necessarily what you as an audience member are experiencing by seeing me on stage. And I think this provides a really unique opportunity for the liveness of the form that I've created. I'm creating a form out of something that's on a page, technically. For you to see me seeing this, and have an experience with me, having an experience together, but the experience I'm having may be very different from yours, but it provides an opportunity to have this shared experience, and hopefully we'll have some humanity coming
I get it.
Does that make sense?
Oh yeah, it makes sense before you said it, but what I'm asking for is in the show that you're doing now, can you isolate a moment? This is new for me, I write unconventional scripts.
Yes.
So I'm really looking at, and I haven't been privy to the process, so I'm just wondering if you can isolate a particular moment where you're creating this, and it may be very different from what I perceive, but yeah, that's the question.
Well, it's personal. Quite honestly, I think because our impulses are a personal, they're a personal feeling. When I'm reading a script and whatever my personal impulse is to create this thing that is shaped ultimately by the director, it comes from personal experiences or personal, by just personal response. It doesn't have to be emotional necessarily. It could be just physical or whatever. And so I can think of many opportunities in the script that happens constantly, but I choose to keep those to myself. I'd be very interested to see, it's always interesting to talk to audience members sometimes because they're really like, oh, this time when you were doing this thing, and I was thinking of this, and it's really interesting to see what connections people make to what.
Well, I think what, in some ways, if I can reinterpret what you're saying from a slightly different perspective, aside from the personal connection and the aliveness that you're talking about specifically, I haven't seen the play, but I know Abby's work and I saw a ton of her work conceptually, which may perhaps the idea is that the play that she's written in particular has perfect. She has a clip.
Okay.
So you get to see it.
You're saying
that.
I'm sorry.
I didn't mean to interrupt. In the very shortest the idea that the play presents in a particular form, the content of the play is delivered by its form, is what I was going to say. And that the form, I don't know what the word conventional means anymore because I think I don't believe in it, but what I do know is that it is a form that Abby has invented that allows for the content to be delivered to you and perceived by the audience. And that I'm interested to see what that is and perhaps even define it. And that's, I think, what I do as a director with the work that I do, and I do have an example, in which the story itself is one thing, and it can be delivered a lot of different ways. But as a director, I'm going to say, this is the form. This is the formal, structure is the right word, because structure means something different when you're talking about a play. But the structure of the performance, let's say that way. This is how I'm going to tell this story. And it could be defined. Maybe it's defined as dance theater. Maybe it's defined as theater with music. Maybe it's defined as poetic, imagistic. Maybe that's how you define that form. Maybe the form of this play is imagistic. But within that, how does that inform how the story is told and what you get from it? Is that helpful?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
can you see something? Yeah, sure. And I'll just say, building on what you're saying, Amy, actually the structure of this play is written in a series of vignettes or stories. And so every little scene is a little story, and then it comes together to create this master story. I think very interested in the idea of story, what is a story in a live performance? It's, what's the difference between that and what's written in a novel or a book. So anyway, here's the little preview. It's cut together. It's not a continuous clip, but maybe we can find a moment that you can talk about. I don't know if it's too loud or not, so I'll just do a book.
Thank you.
online.
And technology.
Yeah.
That'll be a big part of your time.
He's working.
Sorry.
In the video itself,
it's a very
yes.
This is with a piece of music by Paula. It's such a neat stream.
Probably have to change the sound.
I'll try it with the computer.
I was working on another computer fine, so I'm not sure. Headphone output might be bad.
What?
We tried on Mark's computer, was fine, so I think I might have a headphone output on her computer.
Headphone output.
Output.
Output. Can you get the volume because of the headphone output works. I just listened to it last night.
Choose one or the other to play it, and then if I could ever tell definitely what it was, to go, no, change something. So I never knew what he chose to play, but he was doing something specific, and that gave him something specific to do, but then also allowed for the audience to have multiple possibilities.
Yeah, and I think, I just read, I can't remember what I was reading, but I just read something, it was Patti Smith's book. And she was talking about how she couldn't be an actor because she felt like actors in some ways were martyrs to their cause. They sort of sacrificed their whole selves to the dramatic event. And what I think is interesting about that, and also this conversation, is the sort of contextual ambiguity of a given moment, what's going on for an actor personally doesn't necessarily have to be the perception of what's going on for an actor in the audience. And I think that gets to the core of this conversation, but also a larger conversation about the nature of what art is. I think art is about negotiating loneliness in a lot of ways. We're sort of trapped in our brains the only way we have to express ourselves is through language, and language is a really, really shitty way of expressing yourself. Words are very inadequate, and I think that art is a great attempt to connect, and these sort of moments, this whole conversation about form and content is really about that, and it's about this moment that we were just discussing, when an actor sort of has that collision of humanity moment on stage with the audience or with someone else on stage. I think that's when we start to get at the sort of that beautiful content that Lauren was talking about earlier.
How do you guys
feel
film and other kinds of media
Can you say
that one more time? How do you feel like film and other kinds of media changes or fits into the form of live theater?
Well, some people just stick a film on stage and show that, and that's one obvious way to do it. But then other ways are to ask questions, and Pam Bogart did this a lot and talked about this a lot, how do you do a close-up on stage, or how do you do a cross-cut, and figuring out what is, in some way, the stage equivalent without literally trying to do something that literally creates that effect, what's the theater version of it.
But I'm saying incorporating
that. On the stage.
On the stage. Yeah, I'm talking about, sort of going to, I'm thinking, because I'm looking at this image, I'm thinking a little bit more about performance art and the influence of, like sort of the borderline between performance art and theater. And it seems to me that one way to really break the form is that you actually incorporate some kind of a two-dimensional media. And I just wondered if any of you guys ever dealt with that or think about that?
It's interesting. I mean, I remember I saw the Wooster Group's Hamlet a few years ago, which was a really interesting sort of, they had Richard Burton's Hamlet film, which was edited in various ways, but projected on the back wall of the set. And then the actors were sort of trying to match what was happening in the film as the film was playing. And I mean, that's a simplification. But I really just think it was a conversation. I mean, they were trying to have a conversation about our relationship to the two dimension versus the three dimension. I don't know that there's any sort of definitive verdict. I would not one of these people who would say, oh, it never works or it's garbage. I think it's interesting. It just depends on the relationship and the conversation that's trying to be had. To bring this back to what we've been talking about, it's a conversation about form. What's the context of the film, and what is the conversation, and what is the dramatic event that's trying to sort of be communicated through the use of the media?
I've worked on a number of projects that have used film in part of live theater, and I've worked on them as both a dramaturg and a director, and this is purely my own opinion. I think they work best when what you're doing is using the film clip to make a comment on sort of the lack of liveness in those. I think it works best when what you're doing is using it to show kind of what this special thing we have going on in the theater is, sort of liveness. I think specifically in a production we did in New Orleans with Jihad Jones and the Kushnikov Babes by Yusuf El-Gindi, which takes place in an agent's office, and in the middle of the play is a guy doing a screen test in which he's asked to sort of do this ethnic drag of a terrorist. And he decides to overdo the stereotype in order to try and prove a point. And I talked to Yusuf, I said, hey, how would you feel about us actually having the guy who's auditioning for film it live and have the audience watch it on live as the actor's doing it so they can see the difference? And then we can focus on what it is that the camera is focusing on versus what we're seeing live. And it made, and he loved that idea, and it made that scene so much funnier because we had the director doing things like this. The actress thought she was doing a big sort of feminist statement with her monologue, and you could tell she really believed it. And yet the director is kind of honing in on parts of her body and showing the fragmentation of the female body in the media. And so it was this sort of negotiation that was making a comment on that other form that seemed to work. And I think it works best when you have the two forms in conversation with each other in that way. That's just my perspective on it.
Yes. I'm sorry. We also have the TV now.
Yes.
That's everything.
Okay.
Sorry.
Form when you are making, so if you are looking at a theme that you are
exploring as an actress, do you think about what shape you or what form you will put to it? Does it change depending on the themes you're looking at?
Yeah, now you ask me
as
an actress, no?
Yes, as an actress.
Well, then my experiences are improvisations. And so if the theme given corresponds to the message, then I, the secret or the important.
That works.
Is to fix materials and fix an improvisation or a score of movements, and then later this score can be changed to fit into the message of the words. Because very often it's easier to add the words and phrases after the form has been created. And sometimes I have had the situation of as an actress and director of having the words first. And of course you can improvise movements to make the form, but easily you make cliché, what we call butter on bacon. So that's why very often we put these things together afterwards. Of working with you, it was it's a great challenge to try to create material that fit those texts. Because to make a score that says something completely different to the text sometimes is very fascinating. But still, the form created should not kill the text. Of the poetry of the text, and sometimes. So we also come to that in the process, like you know, that the way the lights can change so that the text rises more strongly when the lights go down. And the movements on stage are always stronger than words. So then it's a question of using these movements in between, or because you cannot fight. There must not be a complete fight with the words and the body unless you really want a situation where it's chaos, you know? Okay, so you do it. But it's a very, I mean, these things working with the form and message, very intricate. It's very, for me, it's different for each production because sometimes I like to maybe. I had an experience last year where I worked with two actors and we experienced and we made a score 20 minutes of a work in progress, which I had decided we work on the body because. When I work with actors, I try to look what is in it, what is the strongness of this actor. I have to underline the capacities, the good things in the actor, which is different from movies, maybe in film. Very often the film director puts his view or ideas on the actor that has to do what he says. When I work with actors, I try to see what they have and work from there, you know, the strongness or the softness or the fun things about the way this, the capacity, scenic capacity of this actor. So, and then we created this fantastic score. But this actor had a scholarship from South America, and he wanted to explore our theater. So he was not satisfied. He had to go back to Colombia because he couldn't stay for more than 3 months. And so he applied for another scholarship because he wanted to finish and he wanted to have texts. So he applied for that and came back and I said, I want to know, this score is really like dance. You know, they did fantastic movements, and even with the movements you can have lots of message. Like these two people, with the movements, they were going back to ancient Greece, you know, into the labyrinth of Diana, etc., and fighting. But suddenly he came and then he said, I got the scholarship, I want to put words. We must make the manuscript. And in Spanish. Oh, this was so difficult. It was incredibly difficult. Because certain things that they could do together with the actions, and what words to put into that? Because this, like here, you know, if you can see this thing, certain things like this, what you want to show here with the snowflakes or whatever, is underlining in music and poetry. But if you want to do, it was really a big, big job. But we did it, but it's really have to use a lot of time, and it's the same time, it's the same thing as when I work, now I speak too much, I'm sorry, but also when we had writers come, and the director and the writers, you know, that they will be in a position because who wants to tell most, you know. But I was soon finished, but I think you have had my answer.
Yeah, no, so it's interesting. These are also different ways of creating or finding a way for form and content to come together. It's just a different process. So starting with the physical and ending with the script, or finding, having a directive there that overruns the actors. It's very interesting.
And I think, you know, you're talking about non-illustrative, non-illustrative form. So we're talking about a structure that's created either before or while the script is being created. It doesn't illustrate the text, but heightens it through, you know, contrast, and that meaning is made by the viewer. So we are making a story from what we see and hear, as opposed to the story telling us what it is. It's very, very, very different from playwriting as we know it, especially here, you know, in this room, in this very organization, where the storyteller really is the playwright. So it's just a very different way of approaching the making of the story.
Yeah, and I'd like to add to that, because there are actually three stories. There are the stories of the body, the stories of the words, the message, and then there's a new story created when one is able to make a third level, which kind of these things go together to a higher level, and you can at the same time have a third story going on, and in that way create two big levels. That's how I feel it. You know, like in when you see a good film, or like Tacos, you know, whatever.
Or as an actress, is also using the text as inspiration for movement. In Abi's plays, there are always like certain images and or expressions that we use to build structures with, like a form, let's say, which also expresses the content, but it's abstracted, I would say. It's not that realistic. Yeah, it's a very beautiful game.
I'm sort of so dying to hear that, like, comparison, because I thought of that question too, that Barbara really creates his dramaturgy's landscape out of actor exercises, and Bogart talks much more about imposing a a structure. You know, she her way about creating, Mark knows this better than I do, but you create a play through the question, the vehicle, and the structure. I think that's the three things. And she will impose something like vaudeville or game show.
Right.
Or, and that in some ways has a different freedom than the techniques that you've used. So sounds like a perfect segue into how you create work. Because I know you're very, very, very strong on actor process and training and exercises, and a less imposed structural concept from the outside.
The form, and maybe this is why I was a little, at the beginning, not sure what to talk about here, because the form and content discussion seems to be very much like the mind and body discussion. We try to separate them, but they're just together, and it's an intellectual thing to rip these apart, you know? And so it seems like an intellectual idea to me that the words are given the credit for most of contents, but something, you know, Sarah Kane, the playwright Sarah Kane, would complain that people would cut her stage directions. So she's like, that's my writing. That's image. There's an image structure at work, and it's not just what they're saying, it's also what you're singing and that kind of thing. So for me, it's that too. What you hear and what you see is all part of the form, and you can't talk about one without the other. Some of the examples, maybe this is a good time to do these. Some of the examples, I tried to bring things that would cover different situations.
Can you see over our heads?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe it helps to bring the lights on the stage down just a little bit because some of these are dark. So this is Faust Part 1 from Goethe. And this in the script at the beginning, and I did the adaptation myself, and there I am in it. But it described the beginning of stage direction as that it's a journey across the landscape of Faust's soul. So in working with the designers on it, we really wanted to find a way to convey where he goes psychologically and emotionally. And he starts out the play very confined in his head. He's very in an intellectual place. And so the stage is 4 feet deep. And because he's very heady and intellectual about things at the beginning, it's very organized looking. So the wall of this is ostensibly his study, is very organized and symmetrical. And there's a little window up there for some light, but there's nothing green or anything like this. And then he makes his deal with the devil there. And then his world opens up. So it's a little dark, but if you look at the upper left hand, you see the wall literally starting to open up left and right after he makes the deal. And then the cloth that was behind that goes up and reveals this very saturated, very sensual sort of world behind, and he crosses over into it. And that puts him into, and we talked about this as the set designer Nina Ball and I as being sort of Faust's world, the headiest place. And he crosses over into this more sensual, sensory place that we thought of as Gretchen's world. But because it's from Faust's perspective, it's his perspective of that world. So everything's just beautified a bit. The colors are softer, the colors are more organic and natural, hardwood floor. But everything's still just a bit organized, so the trees are very symmetrically organized because this is just how the guy thinks. And he spends a lot of time in this world getting to know her, and as you know the story, things don't go well. And so in the end, it crosses into there's some killings that go on. Faust kills her brother, and she kills her mom, and so things get bloody. Some people said that this they took this as hell. I never actually thought about it as hell. I thought about it as the blood sort of taking over. So in the upper left-hand corner, you can see Gretchen on the ground, and it's hard to see it, but there's a, you can sort of see upper right, there's some two fists holding the edge of a cloth. the devil is pulling a big red cloth out of the ground. In the upper right, you can see it coming toward her a bit like a tidal wave, getting closer to her on the bottom left. And then it subsumes her, and now it's covered the floor, and there's Faust standing on top of it. And then we're in this kind of blood world. And on the edges of the picture, you can see a bit on the right there of the frame from Faust's intellectual world at the beginning, framing it up so that he's sort of, in a way, looking at this through his intellectually skewed perspective. So that was a way of creating three different worlds for the play that charted what was happening to him emotionally and psychologically, and giving a form to that in the space. In terms of process, it was very much a traditional process in the sense that the script was written, and then we rehearsed and performed it. But then in rehearsal, I tried to use techniques that break that so that the actors are creating movements and staging and this kind of thing. This next example is a project that was done with MFA students at ACT. It was called Al Said, and it was based on the Cid by Pierre Corneille. And the assignment from Melissa Smith, who runs the program, was to devise a classic, or to devise something from a classic. And we thought that play, the Cid, would be a good fit for this particular group of students. And so our piece became about the question, is there anything that we would feel so duty-bound or honor-bound to that we would do the kind of things that these characters do, which are quite bloody and extreme? And it was a difficult question to ask, and when people actually had to answer the question, they physically would stop short of saying, yes, if my brother killed my mom, I could press the button and have him hanged or electrocuted or whatever. Actually having to face the question was difficult for people. So we started the show this with the actors as themselves, except for the one in the middle who's playing this angel character. You can sort of see in the back, the backstage is exposed, there's the exit sign back there. And with these pictures, the angel sets up what the play is, and then you see bottom there, she's in the bottom right, she has a sign that says Count Gomez. So the actors would step forward and debate, talk about the difference between duty and honor or passion and these things, and then they started to summate the play very quickly, and she would announce who they are via this little sign. And then that segued into them doing the play proper, although in our very movement and music-oriented way, but in essence acting out the play, but they did it in about, I'd say, like 50 minutes. They rocketed through the play very fast. Having gone through that, then it comes to the end, where the back walls open up again, and all of the actors return to themselves except for one who's stayed in character and literally has the rug pulled out from under her feet. But she now starts to answer the questions from the beginning of the play, from the perspective of the character rather than the actor, and the angel pours some water on her head, hopefully to wake her up. So it went from something that was very intellectual and analytical and based on the actors, and they would improvise this dialogue at every performance, then to something very set and rigidly choreographed when they performed the play, and then something that mixed the two at the end, having gone through the two. Okay, this is where hopefully our sound works. So this is a short video clip, about 5 minutes, compilation clips from, I see at the bottom there, it says Midsummer plus Classic American High School Dance equals Wallflower. That was what we started with, was the title Wallflower. And the idea was to take Shakespeare's Midsummer Night's Dream, and on the one hand, and just the classic American high school dance on the other, and from those create a piece about shyness, fear, and how we put ourselves out there. So this, unlike Al Said, the story of the source play was never told at all. I think if you watch the clips and pretend you're watching Midsummer Night's Dream, you might see, you know, Helena chasing Demetrius and Demetrius and Lysander chasing her and things like that. What we would use to create the piece, which is very much a dance theater piece, I'd ask the actors to, and they were actors with one exception, was a dancer, the rest of them were actors. I would ask them to take, for example, the scene where Helena is chasing Demetrius and he's saying, get away from me, and she's saying, no, treat me like your dog, I'll be your spaniel, it'll be fine, and he says, no, get away from me. And to work out the acting beats of that and then create movements for each acting beat that were expressive and not behavioral. That's one example. Or taking a soliloquy and doing a similar kind of thing and to generate material for it. And then using the classical American high school dance as our dramaturgical structure, you arrive, you're a little nervous, finally people get dancing, then start to drink and do drugs behind the back, and then the lights come on and it's over and everybody goes home. And that was our act one, two, three structure in a sense. And at one point one of the designers pointed out that the forest in Shakespeare's play is the same as the high school dance. It's a place where people go to get away from their parents, to chase someone, to be chased, to find themselves, to do some drugs, to have a high old time. And bad things can also happen to you there. So this is a short compilation of clips from that, and hopefully you can hear it.
Thank you.
this is a production that's actually having its closing weekend right now. It's called Salamania, and it takes place in World War I, which a big theme of that war was juxtaposition of life in the trench with life at home. So in all the design elements, as well as how the script was written and structured, there was an attempt to juxtapose clashing elements. So for the set designer, Nina, she had to create one single space in which it could be the trench, a courtroom, a pub, the stage of a theater. So the sky back there, you can see it's kind of a theater curtain. It had to be all places at once so that the play could move fast and things could be juxtaposed. So here you see it being used as a trench. Then here you see a few shots of it being used as a courtroom, the place for the judge to sit and a ledge where the witnesses are. Here it's being used as a pub, and there's a few pictures in the upper left. You can see that they're sitting at a table on a little cart, and there's a guy on his hands and knees down there. He's slowly spinning the carts, very slowly. There's a problem with this space in this theater that if you don't move all the time, most of the audience can't see you, because it's a deep thrust, the space. And there was no psychological reason for these characters to get up off the ground and move around. It was necessary that they sit at the table. So Nina made this little platform, and we just had them turn very slowly, so it's kind of like the camera moves around it. And then they can have their intimate scene that you see in the upper right there. And then at the bottom is just a shot closer to the trench wall where they fold the board down, and there's a keg back there, and it can become the bar. And then here are shots of the one space being used as several different things at once. So in the shot on the left, you see the courtroom on the bottom half, and on the top half is a kind of a mental space or a head space for this character, Maude Allen, who's standing up there. Literally in court, she would be sitting there silent, watching everything, but we allowed her to move around and give her a space where she could think aloud in. Top right corner, you see Maude in the center in a spotlight dancing on the stage of the Palace Theatre in London, while the soldiers around her go about their business in the trench. And then the bottom right, there's a soldier sitting in the trench while Oscar Wilde climbs up onto a cafe table in Paris and sits down to have a drink. And then this last shot just shows a kind of a motif. It's kind of cut off in the upper left-hand corner there, but that's a picture of Maude catching a bouquet of red poppies after one of her performances that happens early in the play. And throughout the play, red poppies are thrown at her by dropping them from the sky. So at the end, where everybody gets shot and killed, then the stage direction was that the poppies should spurt the splatter where blood is, and so Nina dropped them from the sky like that to the big crack. So that's it.
One thing that this makes me think of, and then I think we should jump into Amy's clip, if you still want to show that and wrap a little bit. But what it makes me think of is how we get into a play from our cars, opening the doors, buying tickets, sitting down, being prepared to watch something, and how you start. And especially the clip you showed of Wallflower, how it kind of gets us into the whatever realism there is in a gymnasium, in a gymnatorium, or whatever you have those dances in times of yore or whatever. I'm just fascinated when plays begin. And sometimes it's the overhead God Mike coming down and telling you to turn off your cell phones. And that always kind of, it keeps me away from my own process of getting into the theater and how we dip into that. So I'm wondering if there's any form content question in that. If you think about how you prepare someone to watch your plays, and I know you had mentioned that in Marcus's play about you can speak of it for the kind of church moment and how we bring people into the space to prepare them to watch something that's not just a, hi, you're going to watch a play, here it is, which seems a little stark to me.
Are you asking me?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Well, I thought I would show, I actually really wanted Marcus to come and talk today, but he's doing something at Berkeley Rec right now. So I thought I'd show a little clip from Jesus Moonwalks because it kind of, for me, was the play itself. The writing is very poetic, but the play tells a very simple story in a lot of ways. I mean, if you really boil it down, it's a complicated story, but there's also a simple narrative
story being told, and we could choose to tell that story in many, many, many different ways. But the way that it's written is highly poetic, and I did choose to be fairly illustrative about the way we did this. But one of the things Marcus said to me was that what he wanted was when people watched the play that they felt they were in church. And so what we decided to do, I'm going to show you a little clip of what we did, and then another little clip of an image from the play, that the way that the imagery works with this extremely poetic, dense language. Sound is super important, since there are words that were written. So what we decided to do while moving up is we decided to have the actors come on stage while the audience was still kind of in talk mode. So they come into the theater, and the play started with a song. And so the actors entered the stage, the house lights were on, the stage lights were on, the actors were all in costume, but they weren't in character, so to speak. And they were singing a gospel tune. There it is. And you can see, I'm going to show you this. Maybe if you think the lights are just a little bit. Can we bring up the sound a little bit? Is it possible to bring the sound up a little?
Oh,
example of how we decided the narrator of the story, and so we sort of, you could see how the play kind of slowly starts, and she's the Mississippi River, and we, the whole play was kind of flooded with her, and she tells the story.
So maybe a few questions if you have them, and then we'll have some questions.
Mark, I saw your show last night. Great job, wonderful, very beautiful play. And my question, I guess it does deal with form and content, is has to do with writing shows that are semi-biographical. I know JC's working on one right now. Are there any restrictions, challenges with trying to fit a specific story that, right now we've all been talking about very new works, original works. So I know Shotgun works on a lot of shows that are about a specific person or a story. So I would like to hear from the playwrights how that is a challenge for you.
You said biographical, not autobiographical?
Yeah, autobiographical. Well, your show last night, I know that there was a lot of it. Okay, Kevin's my friend who told me that a lot of it was taken from actual transcripts.
So biograph.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. In that case, this is a play about a historic event, and it took place. Part of it took place in a courtroom, and so there are transcripts of this, and I use those as a source of dialogue. And one thing, in terms of a general comment on it, and I've done a few historic plays now, and what I try to do is not interpret the characters so much. By that I mean I don't try to guess what's in their heads if it's not already there for me somehow because they said it or shared it. In the case of this particular play that he's referring to, the main character was someone who was very emotionally guarded. So it was a matter of, in one sense, of resisting the impulse to try to imagine what her heart was really feeling and do that for myself, which would have been very satisfying, and the play has been criticized for not doing that. And then other people have also said that's exactly what they're thinking about it. So, you know, but for my own self, it would feel presumptuous of me, when dealing with a historical character, to decide for them what they thought or why they did what they did. I do all the research I can, and then try to write a play that reflects what happened, and let people imagine what their motives may or may not be if they didn't say what they were themselves. And even if they did say it, you know, it might not be why they really were doing it. Does that answer that question?
Yeah. Are there any other challenges that you come up with?
Well, I mean, I think like you try to keep the facts true. Right? I deal with a lot of science, so you can't reinterpret science. You know, the theory of gravity is going to pretty much be that. So now we can play with it. We can, you know, we're all making it up. So we know we're in a fictional world. But I think I actually love imposing a version of why someone would do something. So an early play, this is a quick example, is based on a time in Isaac Newton's life as a young man when there's no record of we know where he was, but we have no idea. A year and a half later, he comes up with theory of gravity, calculus, optics, all of these things that he's treasured for. So I look at that and go, awesome. We can fill that up with whatever delight and magic and myth that we want. Knowing that, of course, this isn't a lecture, so I'm not actually saying this thing. So I think it's kind of taking especially iconic people in iconic times, iconic moments, and you know, using art for what it is, and let's shake it up a little bit and explore the human moment of that, because I think it's kind of what we get to do is like the behind the scenes of these great figures. But I think to bring it back to the form and content business, I think if you have some sort of theme that's there, especially a lot of these science plays or plays that are about art. I know you're talking about doing something with Rita Kahlo, and her work is so stunning and organic and all of this, and kind of scary at times, and how that informs the form again, and how it's certainly in science. There's plays of mine that are about certain parts of physics and how I can put that into the way the story is told. So it's about stars, and it's about distance, and about light, and how light and distance can shift depending on how you're looking at it and what you're comparing it to. How do I make that part of the play? And in one of the plays that was done last year, there's the way that we understand the relationship and the pattern that this one astronomer sees in the stars is music, because music does a similar thing to what light does for this person. It fades and grows, and it, if you, you know, in various scenarios, sometimes it's brighter for one person and brighter slash louder for one person than another. And so playing with that as a way of describing something, which I think with history and with, if you're basing it on, it's all based on something real, but especially if you have this thematic and you have these metaphors that you can actually manifest, it allows the form to impact the emotion and have that happen for all of us in the audience, not just for the character going, oh, I'm having this idea, and we trust, well, that must feel lovely. But if we can share it, whether it's musically or physically or in some sort of other form, it can hit the audience as well.
I would build on this, and I would say that basically, for me, all of my plays are historically based, just because I have sort of fascinating history. And actually, my play Voices Underwater, yes, the reference that Amy actually directed the first reading of the Bay Area Playwrights Festival several years ago. I think that as playwrights also, and for me personally, part of being a playwright is also representing people physically, viewing them, bearing witness to experiences that have been ignored or vanished in history. And so for me, writing about figures who are female or who were the victims of, or who lost wars, you know, because we tell the stories of the victors, or who were queer or who were marginalized in any way, these people whose histories have fallen to the wayside because they honestly just didn't matter at the time in which they were existing, we can bear witness to them. We can sort of fill in those histories. And why shouldn't we channel these people? Why shouldn't they have voices in our work? I think that's part of what we as artists can do, including for there are people who are marginally famous. I'm working on a play right now. My next play actually is about a very well-known playwright, female playwright, who was, I don't know if I'm going to talk about it too much because it's possible, but the idea that, like, we don't actually know that much about her, but I get to sort of fill out those pieces. I get to celebrate that and figure that out and sort of try to honor that. I think playwrights like Daniel Alexander Jones or these people who are my teachers talk about, you sort of channel the ancestors. And for me, that's really important, not only in the history, but in the process of creating form and content, which is also why we're working with Elsie Lovick, who is from this company that we honor, and that has taught us how to create our own content in our own work.
Well, what you're talking about with Voices Underwater, that was a female soldier during the Civil War. And there's a whole history of it, and it was based on, loosely based on a real human being. But the way Abi chose to write about the character, it was not only imagistic, there was a really strong image of the rocks, the stones, and the button on her uniform that transforms in another way, but also there's an image of her skeleton underwater in the play that's discovered by a character, how many years later? 60 years later. So those images in the piece, you know, help both in the form of it and the structure of the piece, brought forward this idea that you just spoke of, which is to bring, you know, forward a forgotten person or a person who history has erased, essentially, or is invisible.
Just one question for you, Abi. I actually haven't seen your work since that last piece that we've been talking about, and I'm very curious about your journey to work in Germany, and you've come back with a company, most of whom seem to be, or many of whom seem to be Americans, and then you also have that wonderful influence from the Odenteater. My understanding of that is so physical-based work. So you've encapsulated a part of the form-content collision, which is a text-based writer moving in some other kind of direction. And I'm wondering if you can speak a little bit about that journey and how being in Germany has impacted that.
Wow, this is a question also I think that Mark would be able to answer very well too, because he spent a lot of time in Germany as well.
Not
to deflect at all. Now it's no longer Happens Week's Dinner, but we have two Germans, Stephanie and Thorsten, who's not here today, and then four Americans who have spent years and years and years in Germany. And then also we now set designers from England or costume designers from Russia or directors from Norway by way of Denmark, or, you know, so it's this international model that we're really interested in sort of bridging in order to create.
So you did not direct this piece?
I did with Elsa Marie. We co-directed. And it's a good question how I got from there to here. I think that it's a voice underwater is a part of this. I think that my work always has highly physicalized moments. It just voices underwater has more stage directions because I know that other people direct it. So for me, and also because I don't know the people who will direct it, or I don't know the people who will work on it, who will embody it, who will act in it. So voices underwater can have more stage directions so that people have more, and they're impossible to stage in quotes. So that's sort of my gift to the production team, to the actors, to figure out what that means to throw someone up in the air and for them to ground. You know, like, and then in our work, because I know the actors, I know the composer, I know, you know, because we all know each other, it's different. I can leave more space and I can enjoy their dramaturgy that they bring to it that completely transforms what I've made. So I think that voices is a part of this sort of whole thing because it's, as Amy knows, highly physical and sometimes very difficult to stage. I think that's really the only difference.
What about the length of time you have to develop the piece? That dirty little word called duration and rehearsal.
Duration rehearsal? When we're in Germany and we have German funding, we get lots of time to rehearse. When we get American funding, we have very little time. So this time we only had, we got to rehearse in Denmark for a week last year, and then this has been like a 5-week process. So that's short for us, which I know is long for American theaters. I mean, I think that in Europe, people are used to months and months and months of rehearsal.
Speaking as a playwright, I'm interested in experimenting with form. And one of the things I'm wondering is how much of this experimentation needs to be collaborative. That is, the most I might put in the script is they dance or even nothing. And how much do I spell out? And does it vary from play to play?
Is that a question for me?
For the playwrights.
That is such a good question, and I go back and forth on that constantly. You know, I came up in the theater with a group of actors who knew me really well, and I directed them. So I came up sort of just saying, "This is a space in which we'll figure this moment out. I have no idea what's going to happen." And trusted that people would do it. The more I'm in the world, the sort of professional world of theater, the more terrified I am of doing that, of saying, like, they dance here, because then you don't know what that means in Ohio, and you don't know what that means in Florida. And that could be very exciting. I think the reason I'm a playwright and not a novelist is because I enjoy being in the room with people, and I enjoy collaborating with them. And so I always tend to err on the side of, well, I want someone to have an opportunity within this creative space to generate something. And oftentimes actors are far better stewards of their character and their dramatic moment than I am. I feel like my job is to tell a story, to create a framework. And a director's job is to guide a group of artists through that framework. Designers are going to generate that framework. And so there's a lot of creative genesis that happens within the context of the structure. So I think, and in terms of making that a form question, I really think that's about the story. What is the story you're telling, and what's the form that serves that story? And then I think if you've got that right, and I don't know that you can ever really get it right, but if you've got it close, I think that actors, designers, directors are going to navigate your space and probably do justice to your space and probably add a lot to that space. So really it's the question of what is the story I'm telling? Is this the best vehicle to tell it? And if those two things are right, then I think you can leave a larger creative space for your collaborators. In my mind, that's how I think.
Is there any of the playwrights
that
have
just
question, actually, and it's really kind of around the, I guess, the who and the why a little bit. About who are you creating your work for, and why? I mean, what is the relevance? How do you maintain relevance? I guess because you're all representing a particular aesthetic, a European-influenced aesthetic, and there's such an ecology out there, right, where there's a place for a play like The Nottage's Ruined, which is very much a well-made play, or Gats, which is a four-hour-plus piece. So in this ecology, you're there. How are you thinking about who you're creating the work for and why? How is it relevant to this audience?
Slay this all.
I think you have to find a way to make it relevant to your audience. I mean, one of the things that I talk about in my book is the Beckett estate and how desperate they are to make Beckett not relevant to the contemporary world by insisting that he be done exactly as he was done, you know, in the first productions when Beckett was still alive. And in some ways, I think they think that they're preserving his legacy and his by doing that, and I actually think that kind of they're destroying it because, you know, right after the Second World War, those blasted landscapes that he gave us in the theater, immediately for the people of that time conjured up Europe after World War II, and the bowler hats immediately conjured up vaudeville, which was something that far from being empty of content or context, actually meant something to people in a way that maybe has a different meaning or sometimes doesn't have a meaning today. And so I think the best thing that could happen to someone like Beckett is to do to him what we've done to Shakespeare, because his plays are so good that they can take it. Because sometimes what we're gonna do with them as we experiment with Shakespeare, sometimes it's gonna be just wretched on a level of bad that is just painful. And sometimes it's going to open the play up and make it feel like it was written for us here and now. And it's that moment Mark was talking about where you see somebody who their cultural context is very different, and yet they're so in the moment with this play, right? And so I think that's sort of the best thing that could happen to Beckett right now, is to allow his work to be embraced in this context. That we, whatever your context is for your audience, I think Beckett is a great playwright for the city I live in right now, which is New Orleans, because there is no greater study in the absurd on a grand scale than what's happened to the Gulf Coast post-Katrina, between recovering from Hurricane Katrina and then also the BP spill. I mean, during the BP spill, we're sending people in hazmat suits out to the marshlands with a roll of paper towels and having them wipe down the grass. And you were sending them out with pantyhose filled with hair clippings from barber shops to sap up the oil. And that was their brand, this corporation's grand plan for cleaning up in the immediate aftermath. And you don't get more absurd than that. And so what I think has been done in New Orleans over and over again in complete defiance of the Beckett estate, because it's a small enough town theatrically that we kind of fly under the radar, is that people have created these really exciting productions of Beckett. One that was done post-Katrina in the Lower, site specifically, in both the Lower Ninth Ward and Gentilly, amid the destruction. And these great sort of existential questions played out in this setting. And then one that we did at Loyola, where we, environmentally, where we did it in the marshlands, in this environment of destruction, ecological destruction and catastrophe. And what it did for his work was make people want to come and see Beckett in the theater and stay awake and be excited for it. And so I think this question of your audience and how they fit into the collaborative process with you as you're writing the play, as you're directing the play, as you're presenting the play, is such an important one. And so I love that you asked it.
I'll actually disagree. I'll say, I mean, I think you're right about Beckett. But what I will say is that I almost never, because maybe I'm dumb, this could be me being like totally stupid,
But I don't think about the audience or how to be relevant when I'm writing. I think, and this is very subjective to me, but I think writing is a very indulgent, like self-indulgent thing to do to begin with, you know? It's like so self-indulgent to sit in a room and be like, someone should be paying me to write my play. And you're like, people haven't cured cancer yet. And I'm like, why is no one writing me a check to write my play? And I think it's a very indulgent thing. So I think it has a lot to do with luck, whether you're a writer who has a career. I think that there were probably some brilliant writers in like born in 1950 who are writing novels that nowadays would win a Pulitzer Prize. But they just happened to be born in the wrong time period. You know what I mean? And so no one paid attention to them. And that sucks. But it's just sort of the nature of the beast. I don't think you can try. And I could never sit down. There may be writers who can do this. They're just better than me. I can never sit down and be like, what is the most relevant thing I can write about right now? And then do it. I just can't do it. I wish I could, because I think I'd get more grant money.
I mean, I guess, sorry, just not to go into a dialogue a little bit, but I totally hear what you're saying. I mean, and I guess what I yearn for almost is to have, to say, put Michael John Garces in a conversation with you at Cornerstone, because he's coming from a very socially relevant place. And I guess that's what I'm saying, in the apology of theater, there is that place for everybody, but...
I think that's awesome for him.
I'd like to speak to that, because I do think that there are a lot of ways in which relevancy and connection play a part in contemporary theater. And of course, I deeply believe in theater, unlike you, that writing in a room is incredibly important and relevant. And that's why, you know, I do what I do, and I see it all the time. And I think that there are some artists who deliberately set out to connect with a very specific issue in a community, and to try to bring that forward inside the community and from the community. And there are other artists, I think. And I wrote about this a little bit. I really believe it in a non-poetic, non kind of like I am such a good explorer of language way, really that I really feel that playwrights are the cartographers of our time. I really feel like playwrights in particular are charting the journey of our culture, and that they do it in different ways, and that some work lands more in, like you were saying, can land, and other work maybe doesn't right now. But I do think that there is an unconscious drive towards relevancy, or a conscious one, that they live, you know, together. And I also wanted to say that an experience that we had working on Jesus Moonwalks, which I think is an incredibly relevant piece, and draws and speaks to and with a very particular audience. I was a little heartbroken by the production because of where it was produced. And that was a whole other issue of relevancy, which is that the audience for whom it was meant would never come to that place, and didn't. It was full. We had full houses, it was popular, blah, blah, blah. But the audience for whom this play would be incredibly relevant would never come in. And so no matter what you did, no matter what you did, you could park buses somewhere, you know, it just wasn't a place that audience wanted to be. And so I think that that's also an issue when we're talking about theater relevancy, audience, is like thinking about where you're doing it.
I think if you think too much about what is currently relevant, you're going to miss what is epically relevant, which is the grandness of living that has been the same for thousands and thousands of years. And I think that, I mean, like you were talking about, Mark, about giving this exercise to actors, and this is often what I say to writers when I'm talking to as well as like, what would you die for? What would you kill for? What is worth? I mean, those things don't. Those are never going to be irrelevant or irrelevant. The actual word. making stuff up. So anyway, I mean, I think that's part of it is kind of not saying is Beckett about Katrina. It's about devastation. It's about, as you said, absurdity, which hysteria is probably always going to be something we'll be dealing with, we'll be interesting in, interested in. So I mean, that's part of it too, is making it not like we're speaking to you on Twitter because we have Twitter in our play. No, it's we're telling a love story. We're telling something about someone being betrayed or fighting for justice, which every couple minutes you're going to find somebody actually living and dying for those things. Probably not for Twitter. One more question.
I just have a quick one. I feel like a lot of contemporary playwrights have a complicated relationship with Aristotelian form in that, the basics of protagonist and rising action and crisis and those kinds of things that most storytelling that we see in film and television is kind of based on, that a lot of playwrights either struggle with that or consciously reject it or... And I'm curious for you guys what your relationship is with that very classic form of storytelling and how you consciously use it to your benefit or reject it or wait and see what the content is and how that drives that decision. Just curious.
I'm constantly using it and trying to use it not in their usual ways, not just for the sake of it, but just to make sure that people actually feel and hear the story, so they're not just serving them an expectation, but the classic act 1, 2, 3 structure that comes from just how we move and how we breathe, I find very useful in working on dance or devising a piece or trying to break down a script that somebody else wrote a long time ago. I don't feel a slave to it. It actually feels some quite a flexible concept.
Me too. Yeah. Here's that.
Good. Thank you. Well, thank you so much for joining us. We have a wine reception in the hallway here. We're also offering, if you'd like to stick around for tonight, $5 tickets. If you'd like to see Romani this evening. They're about to rehearse in here, so I would like to invite you into the large lobby.